Christmas Fofi in America.
Buying on credit is so nice.
One look at us and they charge twice.
I have my own washing machine.
What will you have though to keep clean?
Skyscrapers blue in America. Cadillac zoom in America. Industry boom in America.
12 in a room in America.
Hello again. For the final time this semester, we are going to close out the final unit here with a brief lesson on a pretty controversial topic that's in the news quite a bit, which is really the trade deficit, but it's part of a larger topic known as the balance of trade. Let's get started with reference to this complaint that you hear frequently from a lot of pundits and commentators and people with bad hair on the cable TV news, like this guy, who say that America has a big problem with their trade deficits that we run with other countries. So people like Donald Trump are out there saying things like, China is stealing our jobs, America is importing more than we export, and that money's supporting foreign industry, and the insufficient exports from America aren't supporting American industries, and therefore the U.S. economy is going down the tubes because of this. And Donald Trump literally says these things. China's stealing our jobs. China's manipulating its currency to boost its exports to us and our imports from them. And they're not buying back products from the U.S. Okay, we're sending all of our money to China. They're not sending it back. You hear this kind of rhetoric very often. So is the trade deficit a problem? Well, so we're going to be looking at in this lesson right here. And what I want to start out with is a fundamental principle of trade finance, and that is simply this: imports must ultimately be paid for by exports. And we could be exporting goods and services, or we could be exporting claim to assets. I'll explain that in a little more detail in a minute here, but this is a good kind of general rule, general framework within which to make sense of international trade and to help us demystify these very controversial things like the trade deficits. Okay. And to give an example, let's start with something we're familiar with, which is the individual, a single person. Okay, a single person does trade with lots of other entities in the economy. With some of those entities, the single individual will run a deficit, buying more from those entities than he or she sells to those entities. Okay, so we import food from the grocery store, we import clothing from the department store, we import housing from our landlord or our home building company. We're running deficits with those entities. How do we pay for the deficits? Well, we run a surplus with somebody else by exporting our labor services typically to one or sometimes several employers. Okay. So I run a trade surplus with my employer, Ball State University. I run a trade deficit with all the stores and businesses from which I import, in quotes, the goods I use. And here's a little pictorial representation to help us think through this. Okay, there's me. I'm exporting my labor to Ball State, running a trade surplus with them, because I'm selling more to them than they are selling to me. Okay, I do buy a few things. I go in the bookstore, buy a t-shirt, buy football tickets. I buy maybe several hundred dollars worth of stuff a year, but they pay me many thousands. I won't tell you exactly how much, okay, but they pay me many thousands of dollars. So I have a surplus with Ball State. Now, here's some local businesses where I like to shop, or some not so local. I'm running a deficit with all of them. They never buy from me, okay? I spend money there, and they never spend money with me, so I'm running a deficit there. I'm importing here. How am I paying for those imports? I'm exporting somewhere else. Imports must ultimately be paid for by exports. Okay, now same thing is going to hold true for the aggregate transactions for the entire country, for the entire economy. We import some products, we pay for them by ultimately exporting others or by transferring claim to assets. So you can kind of think of that for right now as exporting those assets. So here's the U.S. trading, and here's just a few of our trading partners in Europe and Asia. And we're importing a lot of consumer goods from China, and we're not exporting quite that much. We are exporting quite a bit of capital to China, but not nearly as much as we import in the form of consumer goods. Some countries owned which were exporting more consumer and capital goods than we're importing from. Imports must ultimately be paid for by exports, and this is true for as true for the nation as it is for the individual. Okay. Now, what about this deficit? Don't we have a situation in which while we're both importing and exporting as a country, we are importing more every year? That is true. Okay, the trade deficit is defined as buying more goods and services than you sell, and it's technically known as a current account deficit. And I just looked up this data for the U.S. for 2012. Okay, the U.S. has a trade deficit in goods and services of $540 billion. That means we're buying $540 billion more worth of goods and services from overseas than we are selling goods and services to overseas. Okay, we sell quite a bit of goods and services to overseas. We sell about $1.5 trillion worth of goods and $600 billion worth of services. Okay, so more than $2 trillion worth of goods and services exported from the U.S. Okay, we just so happen to import about $2.7 trillion. So we do import quite a bit more. We import more than $500 billion more in the year 2012 than we exported. So we're running a trade deficit. Everybody panic. Well, hold on. It's really nothing to worry about. And again, let me take it back to terms of the individual. Do you run a trade deficit? The grocery store. Yes. You buy more stuff from them than they buy from you, unless you work there. With your landlord, you buy more services. We talk about goods and services. You buy more services, housing services, from your landlord, if you rent a house or an apartment, than your landlord buys from you. So you have a deficit with your landlord. Do you have a deficit with Ball State? Probably. You're buying more in the form of educational services from Ball State than Ball State is buying from you. Even if you're on a some kind of campus employment, that's probably not paying your whole fare. So you've got some form of trade deficit going on with the university. You can be running a trade deficit overall. You can be buying more in some than you're selling. And we'll see here when we do some trade arithmetic in a minute that this is entirely feasible, and it's actually not necessarily good or bad. And the way you'll do this is by borrowing money. You can borrow money to buy more stuff than you sell right now. You could spend more than your income, or you can use assets. You can liquidate assets. There's several different things you can do to accomplish this. Okay, but trade deficits, the point I want to make here is that trade deficits are entirely normal. Okay, for one party, it's entirely normal for one party to engage in a trade deficit, which is technically a current account deficit. And the only thing we'll need to explore here is how a trade deficit is going to be financed. We can conclude, though, that every one of us runs a trade deficit with many people and businesses. In fact, the economist Robert Solow, who we know, of course, from Solow Model fame, had this little quip here. He says, "I run a chronic trade deficit with my barber. He never buys a darn thing from me. Is it a problem?" No, of course not. The question we want to ask, though, is how is he going to finance it? Well, Robert Solow was a great economist. He made a lot of money working at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and of course he got a big paycheck from MIT, and he exported his services to MIT in order so he could import goods and services from the barber and from the restaurant, from the grocery store, so on. So imports are ultimately paid for by exports. Now, with respect to an overall trade deficit, if you have a total trade deficit, meaning you buy more in total in a given time period than you sell, what we're going to be looking for is how you're financing it. And it's always going to be financed by definition by what we call a capital surplus or a financial surplus, okay, which means you're taking in more money in total than you get by selling services and goods. Okay, let's break it down and let's look at some trade arithmetic to help us think this through. The basic equation that we'll start off with is for the individual. I should note that here. Okay, this is for the individual. Okay, this is for you. Your earning, which is from your exports, stuff you sell to other people. Okay, we're not talking internationally, we're just talking interpersonally, minus your spending. You buy stuff from the store, from the restaurant, we'll call that your imports. Has to be equal to what? Well, borrowing. Sorry, let me put it this way. If there's a difference, okay, if you're spending more than you're earning, this side of the equation is negative. How are you financing that? Well, you could do it by borrowing, by transferring assets, and I'll notice you're selling off assets you own. Okay, you could sell a car, you could sell shares of stock, or by depleting your cash reserves. And what we call that is spending down your savings. Okay. So if you're spending more than you're earning, you're running a trade deficit. It's one of three or a combination of three ways that you can finance that. You can borrow, you can sell off assets, or you can spend down your savings. Now that's for the individual. Let's put this in terms of the nation or the whole economy. Exact same concepts, just slightly different terminology. The current account, which is what we call if we're importing more than we're exporting, this is where we get that trade deficit. Remember I said it's technically a current account deficit. It's going to be offset by the capital account, which you'll notice here, this combines the borrowing and the assets. And then delta reserves, well, that's just the cash, that's changes in the cash hold. So if a country is running a trade deficit, it's got to be taking an inflow of financing either through selling stuff or borrowing, okay? And that's going to be a surplus. It's got a net inflow of funds here, of financing, and or a change in its holdings of money, okay? Now the reserves component in the international trade accounts will typically be pretty small, so we're going to focus on the capital account component. And then when it comes to talking about, well, how does the U.S. finance our trade deficit, which again, remember, it's pretty substantial, $540 billion in 2012. Well, we're going to look for a capital account. We're going to look for a flow of money that's being borrowed by Americans from overseas, and a flow of money that's buying American assets. And this is trade arithmetic. I probably should have said trade accounting. Okay, this has to be equal. So when we see a trade deficit, we are, by definition, by math, by accounting principle here, going to necessarily see a capital surplus, or we might call it a financial surplus. So people talk about the trade deficit all the time. Well, whenever you have a trade deficit, you have a capital surplus, a financial surplus. Very few people are talking about the financial surplus, except economists, of course. Because when we talk about, well, we have a surplus of capital, that kind of takes the wind out of the sails of the people who want to complain about the trade deficit being some big evil problem. Let's work through this arithmetic with some actual numbers. Okay, let's say, let's just take an average Joe six-pack college student, and let's say your earnings in a given year, you're in college, you're working part-time maybe, you make 5,000 bucks, but your total spending, room, board, tuition, fees, is 15,000. I don't know how realistic this is. I'm just making up some numbers. We can see right off the bat that, oh my goodness, we've got a deficit, or this person is buying 10,000 more than he or she is spending. Deficit minus 10,000. How is that deficit going to be financed? How do people finance college? One or some combination of these financial account instruments or capital account instruments. And let's just say that you're doing, you get a loan for that year for $7,000. And we'll always write that with a minus sign because it's an obligation. Maybe you sell off a car. You decide, I can get by with a bicycle on campus, I don't need a car. Let's say your car was worth $2,000. And maybe you had some money in the bank and you drain down your bank account. Let's say you take $1,000 out of the bank. So some combination, maybe you borrow $10,000, so it's all delta debt. Okay. Or maybe you had something else you could sell. Okay, maybe you had more money in the bank. The mixture could be different here. But the point is that when you run a deficit, and I'll call it a trade deficit, okay, because we are always trading, right? When you spend, you're trading, so it's by definition a trade deficit. You have to be running a surplus, which means, in this case, now forget about the negative numbers for a minute, a financial account surplus, which simply means you're getting more financing or money inflows than what you're getting from selling. Okay, so we've got a financial surplus, and it will offset exactly the trade deficit, and we'll put a minus sign on it because this has to be equal of 10,000. Okay, and it makes sense when you realize you're selling off, okay, you're selling down, you're drawing down cash, okay, you're creating a liability. That's why we put the minus sign. So it's 7,000 minus 2,000 minus 1,000 is minus 10,000. A deficit, a trade deficit, always, always, always offset by a financial or capital surplus. Let's do the same kind of procedure, but for the whole economy, okay? Let's say, for instance, let's use some actual numbers. Let's say the U.S. current account is minus $540 billion, which means U.S. citizens, all 315 million of us, all together, are buying from foreign countries $540 billion more worth of stuff than U.S. citizens altogether are selling. And remember, we're selling more than $2 trillion worth of stuff. We just happen to be buying about $2.7 trillion worth of stuff. We've got a deficit, a trade deficit. We should actually get in the habit of calling that a current account deficit, because financial transfers are also trade. Okay, so we've got a trade surplus over here. We're going to call it a financial or capital surplus. Okay, so let's be precise here, though, and call this the current account deficit. What's going on in the capital account and reserves? Well, let's break that capital account back down into changes in debt, changes in assets. And I've been looking at the numbers here, and there's way too many categories to do this accurately. So I'll just kind of make up some numbers and summarize. But let's say that Americans are borrowing a net amount of $300 billion from foreigners, and we're maybe selling another $220 billion worth of assets. And what kind of assets are we talking about? We're talking about U.S. real estate, we're talking about U.S. securities, U.S. stocks, bonds, and that kind of thing. And let's say that maybe the change in reserves or cash, there's an additional outflow of $20 billion worth of currency. So that adds up to minus $540 billion. Okay. Remember, what this represents is an inflow. This is the capital account or the financial surplus. This represents as an inflow of foreign money, capital, into the U.S. economy. Now, here's the trade deficit. Here's the actual chart of the trade deficit. This is what people like Donald Trump are getting all worked up about. And if you do go back here to the 1950s, trade deficit is negligible. Okay, it's not an issue. Most U.S. imports are paid for by the direct export of goods and services. But after 1970 or so, we get into a period, actually after 1980, we get into a period where we get large trade deficits, and we've never had a trade surplus in goods and services, mind you, in current account, since then. And here we are right now with our 500 some odd. Well, we're in real 2005 dollars here, so this is going to be a little bit less than the nominal current value. But in 2005 dollars, we're at something like 400 billion trade deficit. Current account, only goods and services. Oh my God, we're shipping $400 billion overseas, and they're not sending it back to us. Well, that's a lie. They're not sending it back to us to buy goods and services. They're sending it back to us to invest in American businesses, to loan money to the U.S. government and businesses, to buy American assets. All of that money has to come back. Remember, imports have to be paid for by exports. And we could, in a sense, we can say what we're exporting here is our investments, okay? Assets, asset ownership. The assets sometimes can't move. Land can't be exported, but the title to the land can. Borrowings and bonds. The holding of that can be exported. And here is the other side of that picture. Here's the other side of the story, which again those demagogues and those pundits fail to mention. This is our financial account for the U.S. and it covers the same time period going back to 1970. Actually, this covers a little more recent time period, but you can see when we're from 1980, when we only have deficits in the current account, we have large and growing surpluses in the capital account. What I did in this picture right here is actually just stack these two graphs right on top of each other. Okay, and I've tried to line up the dates. 1970 is the starting point up until 2008. And notice that those things are basically a mirror image. Now they're not going to move quite in lockstep because there's a couple little discrepancies, and as I mentioned, there's a whole lot of things to keep track of here. So it's hard to track these things perfectly, but you can basically see that when the trade deficit increases, capital surplus or that financial account surplus increases, okay, and it's going to be roughly the same value. Here in 08, the trade deficit, the current account deficit, was over $700 billion right here. But look, here's the financial account capital surplus, over $700 billion right there, okay, right there, right there. A current account deficit implies a capital account surplus or financial surplus. And this brings me to, this is the second and final principle of international trade that we'll note for now. A current account deficit equals a capital account or a financial account surplus. If there's a trade deficit, it must be balanced by a capital surplus, okay, including changes in reserves, asset ownership, and debt. Okay, and then here's my dialogue between the guy here on the left who's concerned about the trade deficit. China's stealing our jobs, man. Well, the business-savvy person over on the right might reply, the capital, you're talking about the capital account surplus. Yeah, China's not stealing our jobs. They're giving us cheap consumer goods, and instead of using the money they get in foreign exchange to strictly buy American goods, they're taking a lot of that money and buying American securities, loaning that money to the U.S. government. Now, is that a bad thing? Is that a bad thing? It kind of depends on your point of view. My point of view is going to lean towards no, it's not a bad thing. I'll tell you why here in a minute. But the textbook tries to give a fairly balanced approach and says, well, it depends on your point of view. And the first point of view, kind of the rosier point of view, says the U.S. is a great place to invest, and that's why foreign countries, when they develop they have a trade surplus with us. They have a bunch of dollars. They don't want to buy American goods with all of those dollars. And what they want to buy is American investments. Why? Because America is a great place to invest. And I would agree so long as we are in a situation where the foreign investment is financing productive activity. Okay. Foreign investment, a big increase in foreign savings flowing into the U.S. is going to expand the supply of loanable funds, push down interest rates, allow Americans to do more consumption activity, because we can tap into this pool of extra savings to borrow money to buy cars and houses, and it will also allow us to do more investment. Okay. Now, on the other hand, you might think, well, the U.S. is foolishly saving too little, and by relying on all this influx of foreign savings, we're maybe setting ourselves up for a disappointment, or worse, down the road, because the foreign savings could suddenly dry up. And what we're left with is we're used to a pattern of really high consumption, and we now suddenly lack the means to finance it, and then we're in for some major recession as we readjust. Another point to think about here is that where does a lot of this foreign investment flow? It flows into government debt. Okay, entities like the Chinese Central Bank are buying treasury bonds, the Japanese Central Bank. This was mentioned in IOUSA movie, by the way. They're buying treasury bonds and keeping interest rates low for the U.S. government. Well, that actually might not be a good thing. Okay. Low interest rates for the government forestall the necessary readjustment of fiscal policies. Okay. At some point, we're going to have to cut government spending or increase taxes to resolve our deficit and debt problems, but China's got nothing better to do than to send hundreds of billions of their dollars they get in trade back into U.S. government debt. Well, that'll keep government interest rates lower for longer, and it'll kind of take the heat off of Congress, so to speak, in terms of resolving that fiscal crisis. What I'm going to point out here, and this will be my final comment on this whole topic, in a sense, it doesn't matter who's financing our government deficit. Okay, our government deficit is an inherent problem in and of itself. Chinese central bank chooses to finance it, or whether American citizens choose to finance it, we've still got a big spending problem, okay, as we've talked about extensively in the past couple weeks. So I'm going to close out this unit by suggesting that our trade deficit is not a problem per se. We might as well say our capital surplus. I have somewhat mixed feelings on this debate between is the U.S. a great place to invest, or are we foolishly saving too little? But to the extent we're foolishly saving too little, I would argue that our problem is more a government spending problem, not a savings problem. Okay, but the trade deficit is, hopefully now you know a little bit about it, and you can combat these silly arguments and these fallacies, and I would encourage you to take up the argument my little businessman here makes Okay, whenever you hear people complain about the trade deficit, you should say, wait, you mean the capital surplus? How could you possibly complain about a massive influx of investment and savings into our economy, keeping interest rates low and enhancing our investment and consumption possibilities?
Skyscrapers bloom in America. Cadillacs zoom in America. Industry boom in America.
Wealth in a room in America.
Lots of new housing with more space.
Lots of doors slamming in our face.
I'll get a terrace apartment.
Better get rid of your accent.
Life can be bright.